Hello and welcome to part three of the series of introductory video presentations on an introduction to Open Data Kit, a learning resource compiled by Statistics for Sustainable Development for researchers, students, or anyone else who may be interested in learning the fundamentals of ODK and mobile data collection. In today's part, we'll be exploring many of the different question types you can use in ODK, as well as how to code them. Examples shown in this video will be part of an example survey form partnered with this presentation, which you'll be able to download and explore. There'll also be a short companion video with this presentation, which will show you more directly in Excel how to code certain questions. As for the contents of today's presentation, begin by looking at multiple and single select questions, and some text questions, integer and decimal questions, a few other important question types that are quite basic, a little bit on metadata, and then finally, calculates, which are a very important and highly flexible question type you can use. Of course, the key part to any survey form is the questions themselves, and there are lots of different question types one can have in an XLS form. On this slide, I put together a few of the most key question types and the ones you are most likely to need for any project you undertake using ODK. Firstly, there are simple integer or decimal questions. Both of these require a numeric input. But the difference is that integer only takes whole numbers, while decimal will take any real number. This could capture information such as a person's age or their height. The text question will accept any text as an input, for instance, asking someone's name or for post-interview comments. These are best used under certain circumstances and are generally best to be avoided when possible by turning the question into a multiple choice input. Select one and select multiple are the two key variants of a multiple choice question. For select one, the user will only pick one answer from a range of options, such as when asking for somebody's gender, while a select multiple, the user can select many different answers. For instance, you could ask someone to select all items an individual owns from a predefined list of options. A note, it's not a question as such. It does not require any form of input. It's usually displayed as a note to the enumerator, either for the benefit of something that should be read aloud to the respondent. For instance, this could be used to display the informed consent note, which should be read to the respondent prior to the beginning of a survey. GeoPoints can be quite useful depending on the needs of your project. If collecting agricultural data, for example, you could use them to capture the exact location of a respondent's farm or their individual plots. They can be additionally useful for data monitoring by ensuring that the locations of the data collections are happening where you would expect them to. Date questions are relatively simple, requiring a date to be inputted, such as someone's birthday or the date crops were sowed onto a given plot of a farm. Similarly, time questions accept time as an input, such as the usual time a farmer begins work on their land on a given day. Image questions will allow the enumerator to take a picture with their mobile device's camera or upload a picture from their device's storage, thereby using images as a form of data collection. For instance, you could take pictures of crops to assess their health or growth at a set time interval. Calculates are one of the most useful question types you can employ. They are not questions as such, as they do not display anything on the screen, but will run a formula provided to the survey sheet in the background. This is essentially an internal calculation which is not displayed to the user. This type is quite flexible with what calculations one can carry out. I shall link a web page which details many of the different operators one can use in calculate fields at the end of the presentation, as there are far too many to go over here. An example would be you could have a section that asks for costs of various farming resources, and then include a calculate which sums up these values for a total. As such, these are also quite useful for calculating variables you would otherwise have created in statistical software at the point of data cleaning or analysis. Therefore, they can be a big time saver if used effectively. Finally, trigger/acknowledge are similar to notes in that they only display text to the user and do not require any detailed input. The difference being is that these notes are generally acknowledged by pressing OK in order to continue. These could be used to check that a question has been intentionally left blank or flag a seemingly unusual data entry without outright refusing it. For the next few slides, I'm going to demonstrate how to write many of the various question types I just explained. Starting with one of the most common question types, multiple choice questions, in the form of both single selects and multiple selects. You'll definitely need to familiarize yourself with the logic behind these kinds of questions to create an effective XLS form. Firstly, under the type column, you would write select one or select multiple, depending on what type of question you wish to ask. Be sure to remember the underscore, and then you would write the list name from the choices sheet for the answer options you wish to show with this question. Also remember to put a space between these two parts. You'll then give this question a variable name, and you would type in the text you would want to appear on the screen to the user under the label column. Remember to give a label for each language you wish to conduct your survey in, as languages are not automated. Of course, these are only the three mandatory inputs, but you could set additional constraints, skip pans, or adjust the appearance of the question. We will come back to these settings in the next tutorial. Of course, there is more to be done with multiple choice questions, as you also need to list the answer choices you wish to be associated with the question. On the choices sheet, you'll create a row for each potential answer. In the list name column, you will write the name you wrote into the type column for this question. In the example before, we wrote select underscore one gender. Therefore, our list name here on the choices sheet would be gender. In the name column, we give a unique name for each potential answer choice. Remember, one row per answer. Under the label columns, you will write in the text you would want to appear on the screen when the user is answering the survey. Just like with the label on the survey sheet, there must be a column for each language you use in your survey. Another common question type was text inputs, though it's not recommended to use these too often in one survey, as select questions are much more optimized for data management and analysis. Simply, text fields can easily have too many variations of the same answer. This could be due to slight spelling mistakes or some users using capital letters where others have not, despite typing the same word. Therefore, cleaning data from text questions can be extremely tedious. Therefore, it's best to avoid them when possible. If you are to include one, however, say to ask for someone's name or any comments about how the interview went, then you do not need to do anything with the choices sheet. Rather, you just write text into the type column and give your question a name and a label. This is definitely one of the more simple question types you can code. As previously mentioned, there are integer and decimal questions, and they are very similar. The only difference being that integer questions will only accept a whole number, while decimal will accept any real number, including those with decimals, such as 1.2. Be sure to use the one which is most appropriate for the data you are trying to collect and wish to analyze or report. In the example shown, I have created an integer question. In the type column, I would write integer and write a label much like you would any other question, as well as a name. We've also provided a hint to the enumerator, which will appear on the screen below the label, instructing them to type in a zero if the answer is none. I have also added a constraint and associated constraint message, restricting any answer to this question to be less than 367, so that nobody can state they are taking more trips abroad than there are days in the year, as this seems quite unrealistic. As such, we can use constraints to ensure good data quality and validity. I will come back to constraints in greater detail in the next tutorial. I have shown you some of the key question types, but there are plenty more not discussed and not demonstrated in this presentation. So please feel free to explore XLSForms further. Here I'm just going to go over another two useful question types you may wish to include in your forms. As previously mentioned, notes are a useful way to display a chunk of text to a user or to a data collector, such as instructions or statements that should be read aloud to the survey respondent. These do not require any input, though you can set skip patterns and relevancies to them just the same. For these, you only need to give them a name and a label or hint, and write note into the type column. You can also ask for date inputs by using the date question type. For instance, you could ask people for their birth date, or for a recent example from my own work, has been asking for the date they sowed a particular plot. This can be quite a useful type of question to play around with the appearance column, as you can use this to alter how it is inputted, including restricting it to only needing a month and a year rather than a specific day. For instance, the no calendar option used in this example means that on the mobile device, a list of month, day, year options will appear rather than a standard calendar widget. Finally, there are a number of internal question types that exist for the purposes of gathering metadata about the data collection process, such as the start time, end time, and the date, such as in the example here.
These can be useful for data monitoring and may be useful to include when presenting the results of data analysis, depending on the metadata which is collected. There are a few metadata options which are automatically collected by ODK, including the submission time, but there are also options you can explicitly ask for in your XLS form. It's generally good practice to group these together at the start or end of your form. These are not displayed and are automatically collected internally. As such, they do not require a label, only a type and a name. There are many more additional metadata types, including a device ID, phone numbers, usernames, emails, and you can even audit enumerated behavior. Though this creates many complicated variables, so auditing will only be useful in very certain circumstances, mainly when the analysis of metadata is primary to one's objectives. Lastly, a very useful question type is the calculate field. They are very versatile and can be used for many purposes within your forms. The idea behind a calculate is that you can calculate new variables internally within your form without directly asking the user for the information. There are many reasons why you may wish to do this. Firstly, you could use this tool in order to create variables that are required in the latter stages of your project, including analysis. In other words, if you know there is a variable you would want for the purpose of analysis, for example, a unit conversion, a total, or some average, then you could directly calculate this internally within your form. This could save incredible amounts of time and effort in the post-data collection stage by recoding or creating new variables at the time of data collection. Though you do not want to use this for every possible variable, as simply some cannot be done at this point, such as variables dependent on other people's observations or recoding of open text variables. But you could also use them for internal use. For example, you could dynamically generate names or numbers which are referred to in the text. For example, you could capture a user's answers choices to a single or multiple select question and then ask secondary questions about these choices, all while ensuring the answer choice is included in the text of the question as a helpful reminder to ensure the question is more understandable. Similarly, you could ask users to double check your aforementioned unit conversions or totals to make sure they believe this answer to be accurate. Finally, you could use them to simplify how you write your constraints or skip bans. For example, if there is a group of questions which should only be asked to employed women of reproductive age for at least 2 children under the age of 5, well, then rather than using lots of ands, ors, or ifs within your constraint to try and capture this information, you could shift this to a calculate using the previous questions to determine if the user is indeed part of this category. If they are, then this variable is equal to 1. If not, it equals 0. You could then use this new calculated variable as part of your constraint instead of the long-winded ands and if statements.
Calculate works slightly differently to other question types we've seen here today, as it works internally. Therefore, it does not require a label similar to the metadata question I showed you before. However, it does need a name like any other question in the name column. Other than this, you would write calculate into the type column. Crucially, when you have a calculate in your form, then another column basically becomes mandatory, as a calculate will not do anything without the calculation column being present. In this column, you can write the formula which defines your variable. For example, if you're just wanting to add 2 variables together, then you can just write variable 1 plus variable 2. There are many operators and functions you can use, however. Far too many to detail here, so I shall just list off a few of the key basic ones that are either fairly self-explanatory or ones I advise you to explore depending on the needs of your project. Firstly, we have some basic maths operators, including addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Some comparison operators, including equal, not equal to, greater than or equal to, less than, and less than or equal to, as well as some Boolean operators, such as and, or. We have also some specific ODK functions. For instance, there is a group of functions specific for accessing response values to single and multiple selects, including selected, which can tell you if a certain answer choice has been selected, selected at, which will return the nth selected answer for a multiple choice question, count selected will tell you how many options have been selected from a multiple choice question, and jr colon choice name, which will return the label of a selected answer rather than its name. There are some questions for dealing in repeat groups as well, for instance, sum, count, max, and min. These will work with numerical questions which are repeated. For instance, max will return the maximum from the answers to a numerical question, which was repeated within a group of repeated questions. There are a number of functions for dealing with strings, such as starts with, ends with, contains, substring, and concat. And finally, we have some further math functions, including rounding, powers, log functions, and other scaling tools which you may or may not need. So, just to summarize today, we have seen many different question types that you can use within your forms in ODK, including single and multiple select questions, which are, of course, our multiple choice answer questions. Remember to define your answers in the answer sheet, of course. We've seen decimal and integer questions, which are used for numeric-based answers. Text questions, which, while they can be useful, it is best to limit their use, as it is often difficult to analyze open field data. But there are also many, many others, including dates, notes, which all have their own uses and purposes. We can also use metadata, which can be useful for data monitoring. And then finally, we have calculates, which are highly flexible and useful, and it is recommended that you try and familiarize yourself with this as much as possible. But try not to complicate them too far beyond your own skills and limits. That is it for today, and I look forward to welcoming you in part 4, where we'll be looking over a bit more of the form logic, including grouping questions and skip patterns.